Late last night, the conflict between Israel and Iran continued into its newest phase, with Israeli aircraft launching at least 3 missiles at the city of Isfahan, which is home to nuclear facilities as well as an air base. Now, in addition to the missiles that were fired, Israeli officials have talked about using explosive drones in the attack, which they have used in similar sorts of attacks in the past. Now, the good news coming out of this is that despite the fact that they were just attacked and in their territory, Iran appears to be making all of the sorts of moves and making all of the sorts of statements that you would make if that was probably going to be it for now, which is certainly good news if you want to avoid World War III. And at this point, we don't know much about the damage that was done by these missiles or by the drones. The Iranian state-run news agency said earlier today that its reporters hadn't seen any large-scale damage or explosions anywhere in the country, and that no incidents were reported at Iran's nuclear facilities. Flight restrictions imposed overnight by Iran were lifted in the morning, and that could very well be true. Of course, it is state-run media, so not necessarily the case, but it seems consistent with what others are saying. And interestingly, in the immediate aftermath of the strike, Iranian media and officials described a small number of explosions. They described it internally as an attack by infiltrators rather than by Israel, and that obviated the need for retaliation, which is interesting. One lawmaker called the strike ridiculous, saying it showed that Israel is, quote, content with these ineffective actions, and a former foreign minister referred to them as fireworks.
Ooh, now, buddy.
Fireworks. So you could say that's bluster, but if it's bluster, that's like, hey everyone, this was irrelevant. Let's not strike back and continue this through a couple more rounds. Then I think most people will consider that to be a win. We have more on this, more communications and more potential consequences, but Cenk, I wanted to go to you for reactions. I know that you produced a live video right as it was happening, but now with more info, what do you think?
Yeah, so that's the fog of war. What happens in the first couple of hours, first 24 hours is not, you know, you've got to take it with a grain of salt. So last night I was livid about the idea of Israeli strikes on Iran, because they had promised, theoretically, they had promised Biden behind the scenes that they wouldn't do it. Maybe Biden might have exchanged no strikes against Iran for a horrible humanitarian catastrophe invasion of Rafah. And so we'll see if that is actually true and that invasion, that assault on Rafah is imminent. Now that we've seen how it's gone back and forth, I'm thrilled to report to you guys that I think the disaster has been averted and that Israel might have actually done the right thing here. And so any strike is wrong to begin with, so I'm not giving them full credit. I would have preferred no strike at all for sure, because any strike risks further retaliation and then and getting us into a cycle of violence, which leads to a disastrous war. But if you were gonna do a strike, this is how I would have wanted it, which is a relatively light strike, not on a nuclear facility, but in Isfahan, to make sure the Iranians know that we could strike your nuclear facilities if we wanted to. Look at how close we came to them. It appears no one hurt, that's critical. So Israel knows how to do a devastating strike. This is not a devastating strike. And so then Iran's reaction is also very important. Do they take it as that's it, we're going to war? Because they had said before, any strike is going to be met with maximum force, right? And now them dismissing it as fireworks is terrific news, and saying that it's infiltrators is terrific news, because you want them to be able to say to their domestic audience, it wasn't really Israel, don't sweat it. And so, because we don't want Iran to retaliate and get into a further cycle of violence, more indications that it was a light tap. Israel not taking credit for it, because if they take credit for it, then it embarrasses Iran and they're gonna have to be forced into retaliating. But America is saying, yes, it was Israel. So that's their way of saying, don't worry, Israel did it. They struck back, good enough, right? Without Israel claiming it. So Iran can say, well, maybe it wasn't Israel. That's the military diplomacy here. Like when you're using bombs as diplomacy, which is a very, very bizarre situation. Doesn't happen very often, but it has in the last two strikes, the one from Iran and the one from Israel. This is kind of how you wanted to go. If you said to me they're gonna do a strike, how do you wanna draw it up? I would have drawn it up exactly like this to avoid war. So that's my honest take on it. I'm curious what you guys think. Francesca, what do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I just like the idea that Iran could retaliate for this and then actually use firecrackers, and there'd just be like those bang snaps, you know, and then pretty soon everyone's just like pew, pew, and then, you know, yay, crisis averted, just gets smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller. That's just my cartoon brain working there. But what I actually think, two things. I think this tells us something about the power of Joe Biden, and beyond Joe Biden, the power of the American presidency. The fact that Joe Biden, this was the first time that he basically said to Israel, no, in 6 months, we're not going to join you in any kind of offensive. And look what Israel did. Instead of doing retaliating in a massive way, They did some bang snaps. They did this, right? And so again, Biden has been saying for 6 months that he doesn't have any control. What are you gonna do? I don't know. And I'm mad. Ooh, mad. But then when push comes to shove and they say, we're not gonna go with you on this, Israel retaliates like that. So you could give him credit. You could also say by the same token, if someone else were in the White House who was all as much a Zionist as Biden is, and then itching for a World War III, a John Bolton, you know, Senator John Kennedy, where would that leave us now? And then finally, we really do have to remember that the ongoing genocide in Gaza is exactly that, ongoing. And this was always, as it was meant to be, a distraction from Netanyahu's crimes.
Yeah, really fast. You referenced there that there are obviously some political figures like John Bolton here domestically, that every time one of these things are done that seems designed to stop the conflict, they get incredibly mad. Well, there are those forces certainly in Iran and Israel as well who are considering these to be inadequate. And I also, I want to clarify something. I think I might have misstated. I'm not even sure that I did. Honestly, I have dad brain. I believe I said that Israeli officials said that explosive drones had been used. It was Iranian officials as part of, I believe, the cover story. I don't know that I even got that wrong, but just in case, I don't want to spread misinformation. And what I'm about to say is probably, it's probably pedantic, it's probably irrelevant. But as we've talked about, I think Francesca, you and I talked about on TDR this morning, anytime you say this started with X, that's probably propaganda because these conflicts go back so far. But I think It's safe to say that at least this round of the conflict began with the strike on the embassy in Syria. And oh, by the way, Syria was also struck at the same time, basically simultaneously as with Iran being struck. And so the strike happened and Iran felt compelled to respond. But they responded similar to, in this case, in a way that seemed designed to not do much damage at all. And at least as far as I've seen, no Israeli died in that attack. And that could have been the end of it. It seemed designed to be the end of it. But it couldn't be the end of it, because despite the fact that this round began with Israeli action that Iran responded to, they had to respond, once again putting the ball in the court of the Iranians. And thankfully, and perhaps predictably, the Iranians did not want to go into a full war that could have drawn in the United States. So they did, you know, they don't appear to be responding. And of course that could change, but right now that's what it looks like. And I just have to wonder, like, why did we have to have this last action? Like, why does, and maybe it doesn't matter, but why do we have to come out of this thinking that Iran was the bigger person in this? They are the one who's willing to be hit and not respond. Like, Israel could have done that. They could have been the responsible player. And look, they were responsible to some extent in that they seem to have designed this attack to once again allow the thing to fizzle out. And maybe it's pointless 6 months from now, I doubt we'll even remember, but they could have just ended it. Again, they started this most recent round. And so, I don't know, maybe they felt emboldened by the fact that they have the bigger alliance. They have the United States and even Jordan defending them. Saudi Arabia, I believe UAE perhaps, defending them against the missiles. Certainly Jordan did. And so I just don't understand why it couldn't have ended one round earlier. Why did we have to roll the dice and potentially have damage to a nuclear facility, or potentially have more civilians die than was planned and necessitate a response by Iran?
Yeah, I think I have an answer to that. I think it's because they're playing poker and Iran has the weaker hand and they know it. So it's not like Iran couldn't do massive damage to Israel, America, and many other countries if we get into this huge disastrous war. They have a very capable military that would do massive damage. But almost everybody in leadership would probably die in Iran. So they know that. And so the one with the weaker hand is the one that doesn't retaliate when the other guy sends fireworks, right, or firecrackers. So that's just the way that this works. So I'm okay with it. And so I like what Francesca's saying, that at the end it's gonna get lighter and lighter until they're doing like a slap fight like this.
Yes.
Like, yes, I'll take it. I'll take the slap fight.
I think Cenk, you're really right. No, just on that point, I think you're right. And I also think it plays into Israel's narrative that they were the victims. In Israel's mind, and a lot of Western media's mind, this began when Iran sent 300 plus drones and missiles over to Israeli territory, right? We even forgot about the attack on the embassy in Damascus. And then some media outlets were like, oh, right, there was that thing. And to be fair, it was also the same day that 7 humanitarian workers were killed by Israel. But lastly, like, this is part of a shadow war on Iran for decades now. There have been nuclear scientists who've been assassinated. There have been generals like Qasem Soleimani who was assassinated. There have been, you know, data breaches and viruses released. I mean, on and on and on. I think Cenk's right that, of course, Iran doesn't have the upper hand, so it's not like they can react to every single one of them. But let's remember who's been doing the provoking of this World War III, lo these many years, and that's Israel.
Oh, I'd just like to quickly throw out, and Cenk, I'm sure that you have thoughts. We should also bear in mind, to be totally fair, responses can be the explicit kind, the drones and the missiles and all that stuff. And then there are also other responses, funding of groups and illicit actions and acts of terrorism, things like that. So simply because ICBMs weren't fueled up or launched doesn't mean that Iran hasn't been doing other attacks or won't respond in some way, but at least not in a way that seems designed to catch the international eye and escalate the threat of all out war.
Yeah, the proxy groups are gonna keep hitting each other, meaning like Hamas, Hezbollah, etc. will still fire at Israel. Israel will still fire at them in both Gaza and Lebanon. That we're used to. We just don't want Israeli soil or Iranian soil getting hit, because that leads to further hostilities and war. And just to pick up on a couple of things you guys mentioned, I agree with Francesca. Biden should get significant credit for this. If he really was behind this, and very likely was behind Israel's light reaction here, well played, nice job, Joe Biden. Now, you haven't heard me say that in a long time, especially on the issue of Israel and Joe Biden. But our job is to be fair. Like, I know that trips people out in other parts of media. They're like, wait, I don't get it. Are you pro or anti Biden? I'm not either. I'm just telling you what actually happened in the news, right? And explaining it in a fair way. Also, poor Syria. Anyone can hit Syria for any reason. That's not even an issue. Like, I mean, Israel now hits Syria anytime it wants. But once it hit a consulate of Iran inside Syria, it became an issue. Like, the Syrians aren't even considered as a country. Like, anybody can violate their sovereignty. And it's not just Israel. I mean, people hit Syria from all angles now. And of course, to be clear, the main culprit there is Bashar al-Assad, who created so much chaos through the civil war and his dictatorship there that has created this situation. But two really important things that John said that I want to pick up on. So John Bolton, Lindsey Graham, etc. wanted us to start a much, much bigger war. Morons. See, told you we could avoid a bigger war, at least for now. Like, they think your only possible answer is war, right? Yeah. And so we just showed you that is not the only possible answer. They were wrong, because they always say like, a war is inevitable anyway. A massive war is inevitable, so we might as well start it. No, not inevitable. As always, the neocons are ridiculously wrong. And finally, speaking of which, whenever I debate these guys, including Prager the other day in DC when I did that debate, you know, they always paint the Iranian leaders as irrational zealot madmen that you can't negotiate with, you can't have a peace treaty with, you can't do anything with, because if you go into the room, they're frothing at the mouth and they just want to kill Jews and they'll do anything. Well, no, they just got hit on their own sword. They're not even going to counterstrike. They're not irrational zealots. They're terrible people. I don't like them at all. They're fundamentalists, and I think they're oppressing their own people. But they're not nuts. They know how to preserve their own power and their own lives, and they've acted very rationally here, given that they would like to keep staying in power and staying alive and avoiding this war.
Yeah.
So that's just propaganda, and honestly a little bit like racist propaganda. Oh, 100%. You know how those Muslims are. They're all frothing at the mouth, madmen, zealots, and you can't even talk to them. All you could do is violence. wait, you're the one advocating for violence and you sound like a madman, not them. And so that's usually the case with neocons.
Yeah. Well,
and you're the one perpetrating violence. Like, I'm sorry, like, let's remember this is happening in a context of 34,000 civilians, mostly civilians who've been murdered. So like, who's doing the irrational violence right now? Israel.
Yeah, and it's not just Israel, it's the neocon mindset also here in America, which is anytime you hear someone say, all they understand is violence, what they mean is all I understand is violence.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, and bear in mind that they seem, in Iran, they seem to be maneuvering politically, strategically to avoid war and still do horrific repression of their own people. We're not gonna forget about the protests and all that. Whereas we have all these people like John Bolton who are not these, you know, godless savages, but they're trying to move the playing pieces on the board to get us into an all out war. So just bear that in mind. And also, I'll give you something to think about as we go to our first break. We don't know for sure how much or how influential Joe Biden was in determining the outcome of this or influencing the outcome. But Donald Trump often says, like, blank wouldn't happen if I were in office. Like, Putin wouldn't have invaded Ukraine. You know, nothing would have happened on October 7th. But what about this event? If it had been Trump and he'd been talking with Israel, would it have been as light of an attack?
Well, look, so since we're all being over the top fair, which is what we're supposed to do. And I say that because just in so many other parts of the media, what you'll see is Biden is terrible, Biden is great, right? Et cetera, et cetera. No, there's nuance here. So Trump actually once did say no to a counterattack on Iran. If you remember, the John Boltons of the world said, you should hit him again. And he said,
that's right.
Nah, it's okay. People are gonna get killed and we'll get into war, forget it. And I was shocked by that. I was blown away by it. And credit where credit is due on that. Now, having
said that, was that in response to them attacking our soldiers after he assassinated Qasem Soleimani?
Yes, yes.
Okay, well, I'm still saying he did. Now, thankfully, in that
there
case,
was still the assassination.
He did the yes. very aggressive thing. They were relatively restrained, thankfully, in that case, like in this case.
Yeah. So that's true. That's absolutely right. That's all of the actual facts of the case. Then you can make a judgment call on what you think, you know, how much credit Trump or Biden deserves. But for my judgment call, I think John's making a great point about today, which is, you know, if this continues and there is no larger war, Biden definitely gets to say, because I was in charge, we didn't have a larger war. And I think that's a big thing to brag about. So let's see how it goes. We're not out of the woods completely yet. But if Biden did avoid this war as it looks like now, I would give him a lot of credit for that.
Yeah.
I think he does not deserve credit unless he actually puts pressure on Israel to stop genociding. So yes, it just proves that he has control. He has more control than he lets on about Israel and about Netanyahu.
No, Franny, I totally agree with you, but I'm just saying those are two different issues. One is avoiding the war with Iran, and the other is the genocide that's going on in Gaza. And on that, he gets zero credit.
Thanks for watching The Young Turks, really appreciate it. Another way to show support is through YouTube memberships. You'll get to interact with us more. There's live chat, emojis, badges. You've got emojis of me, Anna, John, JR. So those are super fun, but you also get playback of our exclusive member only shows and specials right after they air. So all of that, all you gotta do is click that join button right underneath the video. Thank you.